Welcome to Sputnik, orbiting the world with me, George Galloway.
And me, Gayatri.
Death and taxes are the only two inevitabilities, according to Benjamin Franklin. But what if the taxes are contributing to the death?
It's a commonplace that we need taxation to pay for civilization. But the form and rate at which we are taxed can cost lives. Just in the last month, from Lebanon to Ecuador, taxes sparked big fires.
Dominic Frisby is a money writer with a difference. He's also a comedian. He foresees, I suspect, the end of money, at least as we know it, and maybe the end of taxes too. He's the author of a brand new brilliant book, Daylight Robbery, and he joins us now. Dominic, welcome back on
the
Sputnik. Let's start with the book, though there's much else about you to admire and to probe. It's a brilliant title for a start. And I've always been of the view that it might be a lowbrow thing to say, but the title of a book means a lot.
Well, it does. You're very kind. And the title, the expression daylight robbery, actually comes from the window tax. That's where we get the expression from. And when they
were... Because we were once taxed for windows and beards, so would have been...
We were Henry VIII taxed beards, and also Peter the Great in Russia. He wanted to make... He felt that Russians were a bit backward, and he wanted to modernise Russia, and so he levied a tax on beards. And if you carried a beard and you hadn't paid the tax, you would be publicly shaved. People
really?
Would just come up and shave you, or you had to pay the tax and you had to hang a token from your beard to prove you'd paid the tax. And the token said, the beard is a superfluous burden.
How extraordinary.
How
I mean, that's one of the great things about your book, in that you give us the history of taxation. Most people, I suspect, perhaps me included, imagine taxation to be a relatively modern thing.
Taxation is as old as civilization. The very first records of writing we have are tax records.
Wow.
And the very first taxes were levied in ancient Mesopotamia called esretu, which was a tithe, when you gave the tenth. And the reason, and you know, the idea of the tithe, the tenth, is common to pretty much every ancient civilization there is. And it's thought that the number was a tenth because we have 10 fingers on our hands. And it's a sort of a natural number, easy to calculate. But probably the idea of this sense of duty to the greater collective probably existed in the hunter-gatherer societies that predated civilization.
And so you concede that taxation as an idea does flow from that collective responsibility?
This absolutely. This is the essential dilemma. On the one hand, tax is theft, because you are having things taken from you, forcibly taken from you, which is yours. And on the other hand, taxes are the price we pay for civilized society. In fact, those are the words that are inscribed on the outside of the IRS building in Washington, D.C. And this is the attempt, there's always a huge moral argument. And, you know, Churchill described taxes as a necessary evil. And like I say, there's never been a civilization without taxation. Taxation of some kind is inevitable. There's this incredible relationship through history between war and tax, because without tax you can't fight wars. And you know, tax has paid for every single war in history, either during the event or after. You plunder and then you tax the newly conquered territory. But at the same time, wars have enabled leaders to levy higher amounts of taxation. It's very hard to levy new taxes in peacetime. There's a long history of leaders, you know, Margaret Thatcher, a great example, trying to levy new taxes and it backfiring on them. Mansion tax was another idea. It's very hard to levy new taxes in peacetime. You normally need some kind of crisis for the new tax to happen. So there's this long relationship between tax and war.
Aristotle's idea that the richest among us should be no more than three times as rich as the poorest among us would, of course, reduce the need for tax, wouldn't it? And isn't the argument about the method of taxation? You mentioned Mrs. Thatcher. I was myself one of the leaders of the refusal to pay the poll tax.
Good for you.
I was present in Trafalgar Square, when metaphorically, in a way, she fell. She fell a little later, but it did bring her down. And the problem with her tax, the poll tax, was that it took no account of your ability to pay.
Yeah. This is the idea of progressive taxes, where you pay, the more you earn, the more you pay. And hers was a flat rate of poll tax.
Yeah. The Duke paid the same as the dustman emptying his bins.
Yeah, and this was a great scandal. But what actually brought Thatcher down with that poll tax was she imposed it, and it was to be paid to your local council. And the idea was she was trying to bring... She hated all the councils. This was the era of, you know, the Loony Left and Haringey, all the crazy stuff that went on.
Some of it was quite good, by the way, but go on.
But you know what I mean, you know. And she was trying to bring greater accountability to councils because they were spending way more than they were taking in. And she thought the poll tax, because it was a transparent tax, she thought it would do that. But the problem was it was so transparent that... the poll tax went up and became incredibly high and became hugely unjust, and the left actually... She was trying to use it to bring accountability to the left-wing councils, but it backfired on her because the left used it as a means to bring her down.
And now we've got riots everywhere in the world over taxes. The Lebanon movement...
The Gilets Jaunes.
Gilets Jaunes, the Ecuador. These were all responses from the population to new taxes.
Every single revolt and revolution in history has been an uprising at some kind of injustice caused by inequitable taxation. No taxation without representation. American Civil War. The French Revolution, you know, taxes, excess taxes paying for the decadence of the aristocracy. The Philippine Revolution began with the cry of Pugad Lawin, where he exhorted citizens to tear up their tax certificates. And that's because tax is a system of rule. It's a system of control. And tax is power. If a leader loses control of his tax revenue, he loses control of his power, whether it's a king or an emperor or a government as in today. You know, tax is control and power. And so I look at it the other way around. Every war has been paid for by taxes. Every revolt was a rising up against some kind of taxes. Every conquest was an attempt to take control of the tax base, the land, the labour, the produce and the profits. But tax, if you look at a zombie film, there's always this idea of the zero patient, patient zero, which is the virus where the disease starts. And the zombie film, the trope is often that you've got to get to the zero patient, either to kill him to kill off the virus, or the zero patient will give you the antidote, the cure. And in a Western civilized, if you think of the terrible things that are going on in our society, and tax, the tax system, is patient zero. And if a politician really wants to change the world, you know, forget fighting this and that battle, go straight for the tax system, because that's where it all starts.
If you were in charge, what would you do?
I would reduce income tax dramatically, because we have a society where 50% of government revenue derives from income taxes, and we're very skewed in favour of asset ownership against... Because assets, largely speaking, aren't taxed. We don't tax land. So this creates this huge inequality. If you start out with nothing in life, the one thing you've got is your labour, but we tax it constantly and heavily. And so it's very hard for somebody to make something of himself through his labour alone. You have to kind of own a house or own assets or own equities. We're too geared around asset ownership. So I'd shrink income tax. I would also shrink the tax code. It is way too long. In the UK, the tax code is 10 million words. To put that in some kind of perspective, that's 14 times the length of the Bible. Wow. The longer the tax code, it's more words than most people read in their entire life. And I promise you, nobody has read the entire tax code. It trebled in length under Gordon Brown. George Osborne came to power promising to simplify it. It doubled in length again under George Osborne. It's just this, it's out of control machine. And we need to shrink, because the longer it is, the more loopholes there are. One group has the ability to find the loopholes and exploit them, the rest of us don't. And so the result is this inequality is created. So much of the inequality in the Western world is created by our tax system.
But it also covers it, right?
Yes, income taxes. I would get... I'm a libertarian, so I'm a believer in lower taxes anyway. George would probably bite my head off for saying that, but that's what I think. But I would get rid of a load of taxes, and I would introduce one new tax, which is the old Henry George tax based on the value of land. And this is the hardest tax in the world to evade. The big problem that governments in the world have in the economy going forward is the problem of taxing the globalised, intangible economy. Yeah. The economy of the internet, because where is it based? Where's this IP? Where did this trade happen? And at the moment, it's just Google and Facebook who are relocating their assets. But soon, as the workforce gets more freelance, more globalised, digital nomads and so on, workers are going to do the same thing. And it just means the physical economy gets penalised more and the intangible economy isn't taxed at all. And it's like, again, it's more inequality. There's these two things. But if you tax land, if you're taxed on the basis of the land you use and the not so much the amount of land, but the location of the land, prime city centre real estate. So, for example, Google has just owns all this prime city real estate around King's Cross. You are using this prime city centre land. You've built these wonderful buildings on it. That's yours. The profit as a result of the buildings you've built are yours to keep. But the land itself belongs to everyone, and it was always there. And if you want exclusive rights to that plot of land, then you pay a fee to the community for it. And land value tax solves this huge problem that governments are going to face
of tax evasion. Would the yield from land? I mean, I actually agree with much of what you said. We ought to tax wealth rather than income.
Okay.
Taxing income is a disincentive to working people of whatever kind. But taxing the wealth that people have, the land that they have, the houses that they have, and so on, is much more efficient. But would the yield be sufficient to pay for our hospitals, our police, our fire brigade, and so on?
Exactly.
Yes, these things all could be paid for, but it would suddenly become clear how much they really cost. Mm. And then the taxpayer might think, OK, no, I'm happy to pay for that. Or he might go, do you know what? I'm not happy to pay for that, and I think the private economy, you know, the free market can provide these things to a higher standard for a lower price. But that is an issue to be debated by the political parties, and the political party that wins the election, you know, because, again, every political argument is ultimately about taxation. What are we paying for, who pays, and how?
Daylight Robbery, fantastic book. I urge everyone to get it. Dominic Frisby, thanks for joining us
on
the Sputnik.
Much.